Cleanse us and make us holy. Now, O Lord, we ask you with the fragrance of this incense to stretch forth your hand and to have compassion upon us. For you have said, ask and it will be given to you, seek and you shall find, knock and the door shall be opened to you. With unfailing hope we implore you to forgive our sins in your love and heal us in your grace. Accept those who repent and bring back those who have gone astray. Console the grieving and strengthen the weak. Satisfy the hungry and provide those in need. Bless those who are generous and enrich them with their good deeds. Remember the departed who have gone to their rest, hoping in you. We raise glory and thanks to you, to your Father, and to your Holy Spirit, forever.
Shut up.
Glory to the Lord of Paul and the Apostles. May the mercy of God descend upon the reader, the listeners, and upon this parish, and her children forever.
Brothers and sisters, therefore, sin must not reign over your mortal bodies, so that you obey their desires. And do not present the parts of your bodies to sin as weapons for wickedness, but present yourselves to God as raised from the dead to life, and the parts of your bodies to God as weapons for righteousness. For sin is not to have any power over you, since you are not under the law, but under grace. What then? Shall we sin because we are not under the law, but under grace? Of course not. Do you not know that if you present yourselves to someone as obedient slaves, you are slaves to the one you obey, either of sin, which leads to death, or of obedience, which leads to righteousness? But thanks be to God that although you were once slaves to sin, you have become obedient from the heart to the pattern of teaching to which you were entrusted. Freed from sin, you have become slaves of righteousness. I am speaking of human terms because of the weakness of our nature. For just as you presented the parts of your bodies as slaves to impurity and to lawlessness for lawlessness, so now present them as slaves to righteousness for sanctification. For when you were slaves of sin, you were free from righteousness. But what profit did you get from the things from which you are now ashamed? For the end of those things is death. But now that you have been freed from sin and have become slaves of God, the benefit you have had leads to sanctification, and its end, eternal life. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal in life Christ in Jesus Christ our Lord. Praise be to God always.
Touched him
and said to him, I do will it, be made clean. The leprosy left him immediately, and he was made clean. And then, warning him sternly, he dismissed him at once. This is the truth. Peace be with you.
Praise and blessings to Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Stretched forth his hand and said to him, I will, be thou made clean. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. So let's take a few moments today to consider chaos, prayer, and healing. Chaos because today it coincides on this 18th of February with the feast of St. Leo the Great, who of course was Pope in the 5th century. St. Leo died in the year 461, and the reason why I wanted to spend a few moments on him is because he's contemporary with the whole birth of what we call the Maronite Church. Those generations that were being forged under the hammers of the crisis and all the difficulties that were taking place in the Middle East with Nestorianism, monophysitism, and all these different heterodox versions of Christianity that the disciples, both the consecrated religious, the ascetics, the men and the women, and the laity gravitated around the monasteries and the places of residence of the ascetics in being forged in the defense of Orthodox faith, of the Catholic faith, in those 400s, remembering that only St. Marian had only died in the year 410. So this is the first 50 years after his death that immediately Providence unleashes and allows to take place this vast confusion doctrinally. And of course for St. Leo, in Europe, we have the invasions of the Germanic tribes and the Central Asian tribes, of the Huns and the Vandals. And so while the Huns are ransacking Eastern Europe and down even through the northern parts of Italy down to Rome, the Vandals have gone down through Spain, and the Vandals are now burning across North Africa. And in the midst of all this, you have the Roman pontiff, St. Leo, who has to deal with the doctrinal chaos that's breaking out in what we call the Middle East now, and then, of course, all of the military and chaos that's breaking out physically with the invasions of these tribes and nations coming in to Europe. It's not a happy picture. St. Leo is known for his greatness because of the defense of the Orthodox, of the Catholic faith. And he dies in the year 461. In 451 is the Council of Chalcedon. Everything that takes place in the 400s in the Christian Church remain with us to this day. The divisions and the brokenness of the different groups that have taken place over the arguments over a Council of Ephesus in 431, 20 years after St. Maron's death, 20 years later in 451 with the Council of Chalcedon, you have the explosions that take place with Egypt leaving, Ethiopia, Syria, the Far East and Persia. All of these divisions that take place is what forges the Maronites as Maronites. Question was asked me recently, and it's quite a good question. How is it that the Maronites become a totally separate and individual church? Why isn't it just a religious order, like Benedictines or Franciscans? It's precisely the defense of the faith in its purity that forges these people, especially in the first century following St. Maron's death. And Beit Marun, the house, the monastery which was built, is built in 454. shortly after Chalcedon because of the defense of these ascetics for the purity of the Christian faith. And that is completely the time that is contemporary with St. Leo the Great in Rome. So it's in that decade of the 450s when he is Pope that in the East, those who are going to be known as Maronites are the ones who are defending the Catholic faith amongst a lot of chaos taking place. And so St. Leo stands out in a very unique way and is known as the Great, and was known as the Great even during his lifetime. And so I encourage you to look up more of the details of his life, quite famously. We haven't even touched on the aspect of his interactions with the Huns, Attila the Hun, and these invasions. But we mentioned the second thing that we wanted to consider was prayer. And in this first chapter of St. Mark, we are given to show our Lord as rising early before the dawn and going off into a deserted place. He's leaving the town, the village of what we know as Capernaum in English. And Capernaum is actually Capernaum. Nahum Nehama. Nehama in Hebrew means comfort or consolation. So literally, Capernaum means the village of Nahum, or the village of consolation. And it's the base from which our Lord works throughout his ministry in the north in Galilee. It's along the shores of the Sea of Galilee, and it's the place where Simon lived with his family. In this first chapter of St. Mark, our episode today with the leper is couched in the context of the healing of the paralytic, which will follow at the beginning of chapter 2. And just before this episode that we have in the Gospel today, we have the healing of Simon's mother-in-law in Capernaum. And then after that healing, we are told that our Lord himself, with all the people coming, he's freeing people who are possessed by demons. And there's a whole reason why there are possessions at the time of our Lord that seem to augment and increase at that period of time, but it's a different sermon. And then, of course, the physical healings of the different ailments and illnesses and sickness that is around. And so our Lord, to give us an example, we are told by St. Mark he rises early. He goes out to a place which is deserted. It's just an empty space. It's a place away from the village, away from everyone, away from all the noise, and he prays. Now this is placed here, of course, at the beginning of Lent to remind us these are the 7 weeks in which we need to, if not find our deserted place, make it. Turn off the phone, turn off the tablet, turn off the television, turn off the stereo, turn off the radio, turn off all of these gizmos that we have that are constantly talking to us. So that in a place of peace, we can pray. Doesn't have to be the entire day, of course. But there should be a moment in each day that we have silence in which we can pray. And you'll notice that the apostles are out trying to find where did he go. And the disciples find him. And they tell him, everyone's trying to find you. Which is not recorded in the gospel, but our Lord's answer certainly must have been something along the lines of, well, that's precisely why I am here. Have a bit of sanity, and to have a point of when I can actually speak to my Father in prayer. And then, of course, he says, he doesn't make a reference of going back to these people. It's time for us to spread this doctrine and this faith. And the faith always spreads by people. For those of us who are in these pews, we are meant to be the vehicle of the grace of God and the communication of the Catholic faith to others. The spreading of the faith doesn't happen by other vehicles. It's not other people that are doing it. It's this people here who do it. Individually, we each communicate, and it's the only way that the faith spreads. So our Lord doesn't say we're going to go back and see the people we talked to yesterday. They've got it. Now we go. And he says, we're going to go to other villages throughout Galilee. So he leaves the place of consolation, Capernaum, And he goes further out, and we're told he goes all around Galilee to all the villages in the synagogues, preaching, teaching, and healing. And this is significant also that they're both together. Our Lord just doesn't go around working wonders. He goes around teaching, illuminating minds, clarifying the intellects of human beings around him, and he heals. It's a reason why the leper today, because this is the episode at this moment, then we're told in the midst of all this teaching and of healing, St. Mark picks out one episode of a man who comes with leprosy. And he comes before our Lord and he kneels down and he begs him to be healed. But he makes an act of faith. He says, if you desire to do this, you can make me clean. Now, of course, leprosy is a skin disease. It affects the nerves, it affects the skin, it affects the eyes, this infection. And when it's left untreated, it causes a dismemberment. We will lose fingers, they'll lose nose, ears, and so there's a disfigurement which takes place by this disease. Now, leprosy is a large term in the Old Testament. Any kind of visible skin disease. It's not purely what we call leprosy medically now, Hansen's disease, that we're only dealing with. But it's an infection. In the same way that the faith is spread by person to person, so sin is also spread by infection. We scandalize one another by bad example. My conversation on the phone is not edifying. It doesn't raise up. It may drag down. I consent to conversation which may be dragging us down. My actions, my choices, my deeds, my things. The same way that the faith is spread, so also sin spreads and contaminates and infects others also. The leper has that symbolism today for us also. But also it's something which affecting the nervous system winds up deadening the peripheral nerves. A lot of times the loss of fingers or ear is because of damage which is done because of an accident, because you don't feel things as the disease progresses. And so throughout the Old Testament and for the fathers of the church, leprosy has always been a symbol of sin. Something, an infection with left untreated, always progresses and degrades and becomes worse. But there's an act of faith in this man when he comes and he just simply, before our Lord, kneeling and begging him, he simply tells him, I know that if you choose to do this, you can remove my leprosy. Now, because it's also that aspect of the skin, something on the surface, it's reminding us at the beginning of Lent that one of the things that we're meant to be doing during these first weeks is considering what do I need to do in my own life to step forward, to be cleaned, to be made whole, to make progress, so that on the day of the resurrection, of the glorious Pascha, I am at least one baby step better than I was in January. And it will stay. It's not something that's just done for 7 weeks. But it's something that I'm learning to move forward and to be healed. Now this episode is quite extraordinary because there's two things happening here. What our Lord does, he says, I do will this. And he touches this man and he says, be made clean. And the man is healed. Now for some reason, I don't know why in our lectionary, we cut off the last two verses. Our Lord sternly rebukes this man. We'll come back to that in a moment. And then he tells him, now go to the priest. Go to Jerusalem. You go to the priest and show them your skin. Show them that you've been healed and offer the sacrifice that Moses requires as an act of thanksgiving for your healing. This is in the book of Leviticus in the Old Testament. Now, why does our Lord rebuke him? Why is he sternly rebuked and then told, go to Jerusalem, and then also told, don't tell anyone what has happened to you? Which Which, of course, human nature being what it is, he immediately that afternoon posted it on Facebook with pictures of before and after and a picture of a selfie with our Lord. And so he broadcast this all over the place, which is exactly what our Lord told him not to do. And the reason for that is because our Lord did not want to be known as just a wonder worker, a magician, someone who does things and heals you. Remember, our Lord is teaching, preaching, and healing. The healing is meant to confirm what he is teaching and bring them to the light of the good news of the gospel that he's preaching. And he didn't want to just simply broadcast about this healing. But human nature, I guess, they said, being what it is, he doesn't follow what our Lord says. Now, we assume that he goes to Jerusalem and has the sacrifice offered. So why does he rebuke him? Why is he admonished and sternly rebuked before he's sent off to Jerusalem? Because also in the law, this is a very harsh disease. Because if you had leprosy, you were ostracized, you were sent away. They had no idea how the infection spread. Certainly by experience, they knew that people would catch leprosy from one another. It is an infection, as we call it today. But the people themselves, of course, there's also a repulsive aspect. You start losing your nose and your ears and fingers, it becomes grotesque. And so the reaction throughout most of the classical world, and certainly in the Old Testament, is the lepers were forced to live outside the healthy communities. So this man is rebuked because the first thing he's done to even arrive here in front of the rabbi of Nazareth is he's violated the law of Moses. He's come among the living in the village, which he's not supposed to be doing, in order to beg for healing. So while our Lord does heal him and touch him, which is also forbidden in the old law, he sternly rebukes him for having violated those directives of Moses and Leviticus and coming into the village. But now that you have been made whole, follow the rest of the directives of Moses. It's that contact and that healing, which is our last point. And we've mentioned this over the last weeks, because it's something which I think is very important and vital for us to understand. That participation in the divine mysteries is what transfigures us, is what changes us, which is why we are in these pews week after week. If I have cancer, and there is a prescription of treatments that I am meant to follow. I'm free to follow them or not. I don't have to show up to the appointment. I can decide, I've seen the doctor enough, I don't need to see doctors anymore, and I just don't go to the treatments. I mean, many of you have certainly heard from Catholics, I've been to church so much, I've done my duty, I put in enough time. As if I can now cruise for the last 40 years of my life on my own. As if sanctity and healing comes from me any more than the healing of cancer comes from just staying home because, I've seen enough doctors. I'll just be healed. It doesn't work. So we are free to go to the chemo treatments. And we're free, physically, by choice, to stay home. This is the importance of that hand of God incarnate that touches the leper to heal him. Our Lord does not have to touch to heal. He can heal at a distance, and he does so in other episodes of the Gospel. But at the beginning of Lent, this Gospel is chosen to remind us that it's that participation in the divine mysteries which transforms us and makes us whole and heals us. As I mentioned to you probably a couple months ago, our Lord does not enter the world to make us good, polite, tax-paying citizens. This is the last point. Since the time of the French Revolution, the last 200 years, there have often been this argument made that Christianity is a good thing to have because it makes people good citizens. Now, it may make them good citizens, or a set of good parents may make them good citizens. Your parents teach you to be polite. Your parents teach you to fulfill your obligations. You don't have to be Christian to pay your bills. You don't have to be Christian to go to work. But you do have to be Christian to be healed and to become a child of God to enter into the beatific vision. And the sacred mysteries transform us interiorly to dispose us in that healing to be able to see God face to face in the fullness of the kingdom. That contact that our Lord has with the leper is precisely a reminder to us that as the gospel is spread person to person, and sin can also be spread person to person, so it is also in contact that we are transfigured, in the divine mysteries that we are healed, and our leprosy is removed, so that being fundamentally transformed by grace within the divine mysteries, and specifically within the Eucharist, and in the mystery of penance, that transformation makes us something which nothing else can do, and only our Lord can heal them. So at the beginning of this Lent, we look, and each one of us needs to ask, what is my leprosy? What is it in my life that is deadening the nerves within me? What dulls my conscience? What dulls my sense of goodness, virtue, and beauty, which should be inspiring and be fundamental and central to my existence? And then we come and we kneel before our Lord in humility and great audacity. And we say to him, Lord, if you desire, you can make me a saint now. Give me the grace to be transformed so that I may be healed, and in healing me, others will also have that contact with the divine life of grace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. We believe in one God,
oh.
brought to you out of their love for you and for your holy name. Shower your spiritual blessings upon them, and in place of their earthly gifts, grant them life in your kingdom.
Amen.
As we remember our Lord God and Savior Jesus Christ and his plan of salvation for us, we recall upon this offering all those who have pleased God from Adam to this day, especially Mary, the Blessed Mother of God, Saint Joseph, her spouse, Saint Mary, Saint Jude, and Saint Leo the Great. Remember, O God, the children of the Holy Church, our fathers and mothers and our brothers and sisters, both the living and the departed, especially those for whom the sacrifice is offered, for the intentions of the members of this parish. Remember also all those who share with us today in this offering.
Amen.
praise. We cry out and we proclaim.
Thank you.
With all
we are weak. We implore you to purify us from every sin and to accept our offering, so that in one spirit we may call upon you praying, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
O Lord, lead us not into the trials of temptation that we do not have the strength to overcome, but deliver us from every evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours with your only Son and your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Peace be with you.
And with your
spirit. Bow your head before the God of mercy, before his holy altar, and before the body and blood of our Savior, gives life to those who partake of it, and receive the blessing.
O Lord, bless your worshippers who bow before you and implore you. Make them worthy of your mercy and forgive their sins, for you are almighty and rich in compassion. We raise glory and thanks to you, to your only Son, and to your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
The grace of the Most Holy Trinity, eternal and consubstantial, be with you, my brothers and sisters, forever.
And with your spirit.
Let each one of us look to God with reverence and humility, and asking for mercy and compassion.
Holy gifts for the holy, with perfection, purity, and sanctity.
One Holy Father, one Holy Son, one Holy Spirit, blessed be the name of the Lord, for he is one in heaven and on earth. To him be glory forever. Make us worthy, O Lord God, so that our bodies may be sanctified by your holy body, and our souls purified by us sins and for life. O Lord our God, to you
Christ's people and the sheep of his pasture.
And the Son, and the Holy Spirit, the one God, and to whom be glory.